And welcome back to another edition of the Brooklyn Bronco Beat Today. Broncos, like anybody else who loses in Vegas, walked home without money in their pocket. Season looks like it's in dire straits. It will take COVID being eradicated from this earth for them to make the playoffs. And today we have the veteran crew. We have David Lee and Brian Hare. Guys, how you doing?
Good. What's up, brother? It's good to be here again, man.
Yeah, thanks for having us on.
How are your Christmases?
Christmas was great, man. My kid loved it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it's all about anyway. So
I hear you. That's right. Yeah, so I agree. I'm with Brian. Christmas was good. It was more, you know, as you get older, man, it's more like, yeah, it's for the kids. You know, it's always good to get around with family. Sometimes, you know, there's some family like, oh, you know what, Christmas or not.
That's your argument for Halloween. And yet I'm hearing more adults go out on Halloween now.
Yeah. I'm a New Year. My favorite holiday is New Year's. I love New Year's for multiple reasons, man. It's a fresh start to a year, you know, fresh ideas, you know, fresh routines, you know, just a whole nother year of just prosperous growth. So I was like New Year's plus. So the night before, I definitely have my whiskey, you know. So I was just like Brian. Actually, I was able to snag one of these bad boys,
yeah.
Brian.
Yeah. Oh, wow. All
right. Right on.
Oh, yeah.
I got them both.
You know anything Broncos related, brother? I had to tell you right now. I had to have a connect in Colorado. Fortunately for me, I have a couple of friends who live in Colorado.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was like, you know what? Hey, hook the brother up.
Did they hook you up with the Game Time vodka too?
No, what?
Yeah, they have a Broncos vodka too.
Oh wow.
Oh no. I got, you got me, man. You got me. Ah.
I'll take my candy from Greece. But anyway, Broncos go to Vegas, and if you need a sign that house needs to be clean. Not only do the Broncos have a winless drought against Kansas City, they officially have a winless drought against the Raiders. And how do we make sense of this? I mean, in the last two games, the Broncos defense has let up 17 points and 15 points.
Andrew, stop. Listen, I'm going to give the defense a pass. They've been saving us so many games. I'm not even mad at the defense. I don't care what they gave up. I don't care. The 17, 18 points, whatever they gave up. I'm so mad at the offense. It's not even funny. You have that many weapons on your offense. I don't care if Drew Lock was the quarterback. I don't care if Teddy Bridgewater was the quarterback. It comes down to scheme for me, right? So, you know, like we talked about this 3-4 times on the show, Andrew. Coming up with an identity for Denver, right? And as soon as we develop an identity, you're like, okay, we have Melvin Gordon and Javonte Williams, and not to mention the Raiders, who are terrible on the run, right? So, okay, you think going into the game, we're going to scheme hard. I don't care if we get stopped the first four, a few drives. We're going to still pound the rock until we wear their defense out. No, we didn't. We gave up on that. And then it was just like – And so the thing about Drew Lock too, I feel bad, even though I'm not a Drew Lock fan at this point that I was earlier. I do feel bad because he had no time with, the routines that you have with the receivers, have the balls that they throw. I mean, the quarterback throws at receivers. They're different than Teddy Bridgewater's, right? Drew throws a bullet pass. Teddy throws them floating passes. So when you have a receiver trying to catch a ball from Drew Lock versus Teddy Bridgewater, it's going to be different. Even though, yes, they're paid to catch balls. I just still feel like the timing off, timing and relationship with receivers is off, and therefore knowing that you would think they would run the ball more. No, we botched that one. So I'm gonna give a defensive pass on this one and blame more of the offensive scheme and play calling again.
I give Pat Schumer, realizing he has Javonte Williams, didn't realize he had it in the first few weeks of the season, realized what he had later on. And I guess he counted on Javonte Williams for bailing out his terrible play calling. And, you know, even the worst defenses are hep to it. Like, okay, all we have to do is rush the middle or rush one side. Just stop the run game and make these ridiculous passing plays for the Broncos somehow work. I feel like that's what the MO has been for opposing teams down the stretch.
Those deep passes. Go ahead, Brian. Go ahead.
Sorry. Here's the thing. Like, even if you scheme to stop the run, your team, your offensive line is supposed to be, after 17 weeks, probably the best in zone protection, right? You have two running backs that are going for 1,000 yards this season. So your zone blocking scheme should be on that. And you should be winning that side of the ball, especially against the Raiders, who are ranked like 28th, I think, against the run. So I don't see how you don't stick with it, even though you're getting beat. There's no reason for the offensive line to get beat at that point. So I'm just at a loss as far as that goes. I'm not really sure why you throw a screen pass at 3rd and 15. I'm not really sure as to, you know, Drew Lock. I just read Drew Lock had the 3rd highest QBR rating this week.
That's very interesting.
Right. You wouldn't think about that watching the game. You're like,
considering,
right, you wouldn't think that.
Considering that the only production on offense was a Secret Santa gift from Bradley Chubb on that pick almost 6.
Yes.
Yeah, pretty much. And so I looked at that and I was kind of blown away by it. But at the same time, I'm sitting here going, okay, if that's actually true, which of course is Twitter, so you never know if it's true or not, you know, you have to be able to, you know, capitalize on that somehow. And they just weren't able to do it this week at all. And it was hard to watch. It was actually really hard to watch.
I'm always a fan of competitive games, especially with like teams I don't like. And again,
yeah,
like they did convert a huge fourth down late. I give them props for that. But right after that, you should get the mojo flowing. You know, don't worry about crowd noise. I saw a lot of orange in Vegas on Sunday.
There was a ton of orange. And here's the thing too, is that you would have a big play of like maybe 10 or 15 yards, and then it would just stop. There was no creativity. There was no scheme. I'm with David here. Like, there was no, the Broncos had an identity of a run first team. He got stopped, and all of a sudden Shermer can't do anything. Can't call the right play to save his life.
You're holding your breath every play. It's just like, oh gosh, one play we're like, oh, okay. I think people forget in football, man. I played football since I was in elementary school, all the way through high school. Pee-wee football. And I played, people don't know this either. Chandler Jones was in NFL right now. So he played at a rival high school when I was a kid. I also played against Akeem Nicks, who played for the Giants, when I actually lived in Charlotte before I moved to New York. So before I left Charlotte to move to New York, I played against Chris Leak, who played for Florida Gators and won a championship before Tim Tebow. So he was the quarterback of a rival team that we played. Uh-huh. I played with Akeem Nicks. And then when I moved to New York, I played against so many different athletes. It's not even funny. But anyway, going back to basics of football, if you start the run game opens up the pass game, right? So if you come up with that, using that as your identity, if you knew running up the middle was not getting us any yards, why not try to bounce it on the outside? You give Javonte Williams, like the passes that we did against the Chargers. If you look at those plays where we ran against the Chargers, if you give Javonte Williams a space, and give the man the ball, or even threw some passes to him. We didn't throw any passes to Javonte Williams last week. That was the frustrating thing. Like it was I thought they were gonna get him more and more involved in the passing game, and they didn't. And so that was the frustrating part. And then starting the game with Melvin Gordon, I love Melvin Gordon. But if you've seen over the last 3-4 weeks, the production that you've been getting out of Javonte Williams, start Javonte Williams, right? You have a veteran back in case something happens to Javonte, but you start Javonte Williams and get him to a rhythm. The problem is none of the Broncos ever get into any kind of rhythm at all because we're switching it so fast. It's like, we're gonna ditch this and go to something else. And then, therefore, Drew Lock, I'm not surprised based off what Brian said about him having the third best when you're throwing the easy passes, the gimme passes, of course your QBR is going to be good. We didn't really – if you watch the game, anybody with their trained eye watched the game, there was no threat in that entire game that we're like, oh, our offense is dominating. If it wasn't for our defense, that's why I said I'm going to give a defense a pass. They're the one that kept us in it. The defense is the one that kept us in the game. The big turnovers, the hustle plays. If our offense not to get many points is disappointing, and we know we can beat the Raiders and the Chiefs.
That was a very winnable game.
Back to what you said about all the name drops you had. When I went to Temple in Philly, Brandon McManus was the kicker. And wow. I'm pretty sure I met him at a fraternity party. I remember arguing
with him later at Temple. Don't let out those secrets. Don't let out Brandon's secrets. What happened at that party stays at the party.
I forgot, Andrew, to tell you. When I first moved to New York, I got into wrestling, right? And so guess who happened to be the all-star wrestlers when I moved to New York? John Jones, which is Chandler's brother, and Arthur Jones. So I kept hearing about these guys. Arthur Jones won a ring with the Ravens, and then Chandler obviously is playing for the Cardinals, and John Jones is a UFC champion. So, but yeah, when I moved to New York, they're like, "Oh, you gotta meet these guys." And we actually scrimmaged against them when I first got to New York, our high school. So interesting, very interesting, man. So I've been around some ball players, but that's crazy. Brandon McManus, man. I heard he was mad at Fangio during the game. I never found out why he was yelling at Fangio on the sideline.
So apparently,
when the kicker's mad at the coach, that's a sign. I totally agree. Like, if your running game is not working and your passing game is short to begin with, why not use a guy like Javonte? Like, that totally makes sense. Again, these are just signs that it's time to clean house. Brian, your next point.
Yeah, Fangio came on and said that he was upset, or McManus was upset because he didn't have time to go and set his kick. Because apparently they were late getting the ball down and they didn't have the measurement right, and nobody could see what the measurement was, whether it was 4th-and-1, 4th-and-2, 4th-and-3. Vic says that he would have gone for it at 4th-and-2, but they didn't set it until there was like 15 seconds left on the play clock. So that's why he says Brandon McManus was mad. I think Brandon McManus is mad because he's a leader on the team and he's looking at his coach going, "You're an idiot."
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, I agree with you, Brian. That's exactly what I think. I think he was pissed off.
The last of the Super Bowl 50 roster. The man who kicked Denver to the Super Bowl.
Yes.
Yeah, and then
we seem to be frozen. I'll tell me this. Well, we're frozen, so we're going to take a quick break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Are you against players getting paid? No. Is that what it is?
No,
Are you against that? Are you against capitalism?
That's an old... What? What are you talking about? What?
Someone in their 40s and 50s.
Old, like,
come on, man. We got to make sure. We got to make sure. You know what I'm saying? We got to make sure that we in the building when we... You know what I'm saying? No, stop it.
Wait. Do he not on the list? No.
He does not belong in Mount Rushmore. He plays in
play indoors. Dan Marino plays in play in.
You know, thinking about the situation with Drew, it's not that I'm not a Drew Lock fan, and you know, not that I don't like Teddy Bridge. I love Teddy Bridgewater, and I like what Drew has done. And actually, I'll take this back. I'll say it this way: I like what Teddy Bridgewater has brought to the table this year. It's just been nothing spectacular. Just completing passes, bare minimum, right? So both it's been bare minimum for him. So the slight against Drew. Is Drew hasn't had an opportunity this season to start games consistently enough to build rapport with those guys. And he's dealt with, you know, practice squad reps and the timing's off with his receiver. So that obviously hurts us. Play calling in those situations hurt us too, because if you watch some of those drop balls with, you know, Jerry Jeudy, which is disappointing, Noah Fant, some of those balls are over their heads or, you know, not accurate passes. Some of them it was on a receiver. Drew has a habit of getting happy feet, which kind of kills Drew's, success. You know, with his feet. As Brian was saying right before last topic, Teddy being have an opportunity to start this week, I think is a bad idea. If Denver decides to put Teddy in, I think it was actually hurtful to us. I think with this season coming to an end pretty much for our playoff hopes, there's no point in playing Teddy Bridgewater. We know what Teddy Bridgewater brings. At least Drew has an upside. Even with his loss, he has more upside being able to connect with deep passes downfield, which ultimately will help our run game. Because as you saw with the Raiders blitz us even 16% of the time that they did blitz us. They knew if they just stacked the box and put pressure on Drew, we weren't going to do anything downfield. We didn't. We just ran the ball. So when you're one dimensional, teams will beat you every single time. Every single time. So that's my issue with our play calling. It starts at the top. We learned that with the Giants. Pat Shurmur has not developed, as Brian mentioned before, a realistic offense for this modern NFL. He hasn't. He just continues to go old school, and it didn't work with the Giants, which is why he lost his job with the Giants. With that talent, with the talent the Giants had, it's not no slouch team. He just could not make it happen. You had Evan Ingram, similar to Noah Fant. You have really good wide receivers that they had, and just could not make it work. You had Saquon Barkley, could not make it work, and therefore here we're doing the same thing. And then the accountability from Vic Fangio. Disappointing to watch his press conferences. He rarely took accountability for coaching at all. Each week.
From the New York perspective, sorry to cut you off.
No, that's good.
My friend from high school, diehard Giant fan, realized Pat Shurmur was our OC and then texted me out of the blue and going, now I know why the Broncos are having problems.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They had a running back
like
Saquon. They have a running back like Saquon, and since Eli Manning's second-to-last season, I'm going to say third-to-last season, actually, the Giants have had ugly, hideous, disgusting O-line problems.
Well, here's the thing, too, is, like, even losing that game on Sunday, the Broncos' defense moved in to first place overall in the NFL as the best defense.
Wow. Yeah,
they're number one in overall defense, right? But your offense is ranked 29th. So that's going to tell you exactly what's wrong with our team. If we have the number one defense in the NFL and the 29th ranked offense in the NFL with all the talent, with those receivers that we have, with those two running backs that we have, it doesn't matter if it's Teddy or if it's Drew back there. You know what I mean? It shouldn't matter at all. We should be that should be the concentration right there, and that should be the tell of who gets fired in the offseason and who doesn't.
Just hear me at one point though. Hold on, Andrew. Y'all, we got beat by Hunter Renfro and Josh Jacobs. There's not a player on that team.
Oh my God, that's like the fourth time where the Raiders had the lead on us in Oakland/Las Vegas, and we needed to stop them on third down before they can kneel it out. And instead of running, a lollipop pass for like 40 yards game. That's not the first time that's happened, and I'm very disappointed that the Broncos didn't see that coming.
Well, it's like it's simple Madden, man. Like I said in the Broncos blogs, man, it's simple Madden. It is. It's like at some point you're like, if they've been running. At some point they're gonna get slick and try to do something different. And you think Denver's going to adjust? No adjustment. And even last week, what happens is Denver over pursues and then we get blown right in the middle every single time, going right across the middle every single time. From over pursuit.
Brian made a very valid point on game day. It was the Broncos defense did jump from fourth to first, but you know, you get the momentum back for your team, you get the lead. And what do you do on your next defensive drive? You give up two bogus scoring plays. Like Bengals, the two-play Bengal drive. Where the Bengals took the lead back. And then the opening drive of the second half, the Raiders basically said, okay, sorry about that technical difficulty. We're back, and we're going to control this game.
That's what seems to be the MO for this team. There are flashes of brilliance, right? Doesn't matter. You have Javonte Williams, who just trucks people. And then you have Melvin Gordon go for a 40-yard gain here and there. Or you have, you know, Teddy actually hits an actual receiver for a pass play instead of a running back. And then you have, you know, plays like Bradley Chubb pulled off, you know, this past week on defense. And you know, you have defensive showings of getting 3 or 4 sacks a game, hitting the turnover margin pretty well, you know, and then you have these boneheaded plays where it costs your team a win. And whether it's penalties at the wrong time or receivers dropping balls at the wrong time or you know, the defense giving up that one drive every time, it's like that sums up your season. The whole Vic Fangio said it, death by inches. That was the first thing he said when he got hired. He wanted to eliminate death by inches, right? Well, his death by inches
is 3 feet.
Has grown from death by inches to death by feet. Because it happens every single time.
Okay, moving on. We still have 2 games left in this season. Like I said, Broncos just went out and hope for the best. COVID eradicated from this planet. Dinosaurs walking the earth again, and maybe we have a shot at that 7 seed. And we go into week 17 with a matchup in Los Angeles against the Chargers. Last time the two teams met, the Broncos, you know, did their homework. They had a bye week. They came back and they played a really great game. Defense stayed strong. Teddy managed the game. Broncos did not have to sweat Justin Herbert and the Chargers. What did the Broncos have to do to go for the sweep and prevent 2 AFC West teams that are not named Denver to go to the playoffs?
They gotta get to Herbert. That's it. I mean, to me, Herbert is like a once in a generational talent, and the Chargers have their franchise quarterback for the next 10 years. But the knock on him is if you get him outside pressure, and he turned it into the ball. He's not Patrick Mahomes. He can't recover from that very well. So you have to get to him. You have to pressure him. You have to make him uncomfortable in order to beat this team. And the Broncos did it last time, so they got to come after him again this time.
Yeah, we have to do if our defense does what it did last time and hold them on defense, no matter what, if you look at all of our games this year, you know, averaging 16 points a game is not going to cut it in NFL. It's not. We've seen that for the last three, four seasons with Denver. It's not even that, like I said, I mentioned at the beginning of the show, it's not so much the defense that I ever get worried about, because our defense, even when they do give up big plays or a couple touchdowns in a game, an NFL offense should be able to score more than 16, 17 points a game. And when we have no rhythm on offense, it doesn't scare anybody. You watch those games and it's like you hold your breath every drive, every single drive. There's not one drive I'm like, oh, I feel confident we're about to go down the field and score. It's almost like we're nervous to play football. I watched the Lions who go out there, even with the Lions record being, you know, 2-1, God knows whatever it is at this point. They go out there and ball. Lions drive. They go out there and play like they are a championship caliber team. With Denver, I'm over here looking at Denver's weapons. I'm like, our weapons on paper, again, on paper, can match up against anyone on the league. In the league, you have a quarterback like Joe Burrow that plays for Denver. We're winning a championship. It is what it is. We're winning a championship. There's too many weapons to not be good. So going against the Chargers this week, we have to score points. We cannot rely on the defense to win the game. We have to score points. And so that's why I petitioned that Denver plays Drew Lock this week, because we know what Teddy's going to do. And if Drew Lock can just hold on to the ball and make just decent passes and get those receivers the ball, I think we can win the game again. I think we can close out the Chargers and give the Chiefs a run for the money. There hasn't been one game all season, even when we have blown out, there hasn't been one game all season where I'm like, Denver can't compete with these guys with a solid quarterback. I never felt that any team was better than us. We just shot ourselves in the foot and then capitalized. So I think we can do it this week. I think we can close up the Chargers. Again, like Brian said, just get pressure on Herbert and score points. So just got to score points.
At this point of the season, the way things are going is just about – for me, it's just about playing for pride, especially in your division. You know how stacked the rest of your division is. You got to let them know that, all right, we might not see you guys – immediately into the new year, but we're building something, and if you're not careful, we could still beat you.
Yeah, and we're auditioning for new coaches and new quarterbacks and talent in the offseason.
The Broncos said they were announcing big moves on Monday, and I didn't hear a peep. And I saw earlier today that Doug Peterson was interviewing for the Jaguars job, and I'm looking at the Baltimore Ravens. You know, this was a team, you know, that, you know, always comes out as gangbusters. They were like at one point the number one seed. Mm-hmm. And granted, because of injuries, but, you know, still bowling to the best of their abilities against teams like Green Bay. They've let some games slip by them where they're on the outside looking in, and the Miami Dolphins out of nowhere, from 1-7 to 8-7, sitting comfortably in that spot. Does Baltimore like overthink this and let John Harbaugh walk?
Never. I don't even care if they fail this rest of the season. When they know what they have in Lamar Jackson, and they know they had to overcome the odds anyway at the beginning of the season when you had your corners and your running backs go down. They had to overcome crazy odds in the first place. So with the amount of injuries that the Ravens sustained this year, including the quarterback position, I have no doubt that John Harbaugh is not going anywhere. Although I would love to take his brother from Michigan. I would absolutely love to take his brother from Michigan.
That's interesting. This is the time of year I watch college football because we're looking at future Broncos playing.
Yes.
I almost went to the Pinstripe Bowl tomorrow. But
I would highly recommend. So I heard a floater of some other mock drafts, I think outside of McShay. But I would definitely take the Liberty quarterback. I can't remember his name. He's a mobile quarterback with a great arm.
Take it.
I would take him. I watched this man in a couple of games after that mock draft came out, and I was like, I love it. So yes. I know this is not a crazy year for quarterbacks, but right now, to be honest with you guys, I know you want to play for pride. I want to play for a draft pick. I do. I want to listen. If we're not doing anything the rest of the season. We play hard. You know, we show what we got. Our young guys play the young guys. Play Drew Lock. Play all of our young guys and see what we have.
My philosophy with that is to tank at this point, or with a record like ours, that's not fair to the fans. Like the Jets last year when they were all 14.
Andrew, if it was about the fans, Andrew, we'd have fired coaches. We'd have changed their play calling. We would have had our young guys playing. These guys don't care. Two things about the fans.
Well, remember in 2010, when Josh McDaniels was let go almost immediately, just before. Yeah. And
hey guys, I'm having some technical stuff going on with my phone here.
Yeah, just like I gotta hop off. All right, Brian, thank you for coming on. Happy New Year.
Okay, all right, buddy. You too. Sorry about that.
No worries. This is an episode of technical difficulties, but we play what we got.
All right, brother.
But you know, the way the Broncos ownership might be heading, I think that's why they're letting everybody play out and do what they have to do.
Right. No, I get it. And I think, obviously we've heard rumors about new ownership and obviously the sale of the team will happen in the spring. So I think playing for the fans, I respect that. I love, as a fan, diehard fan, like I said, I'm in my Broncos room upstairs. I respect that. However, knowing, being a realist, I'm like, okay, at this point, the fans know what we have at this point. I think most fans are like, listen, we're ride or die Broncos fans, but we also want to see, we've seen our young guys. We've had to overcome a lot of odds too. And we want to just see it finish the season strong. If we win, we win. If not, play the young guys, see what we have in those guys, and then prepare for your off season. Come up with, find out who you want to keep around, who we need to trade. I heard somebody want to trade Jerry Jeudy this offseason. So,
that's for the fantasy quarterback.
Yeah,
the quarterback dreams a lot of Bronco fans are having. We're gonna save all that talk for Week 19 when coaching changes are most likely gonna be made and what to expect. That's gonna be in our season finale, but. For now, so with the Broncos to beat the Chargers, finish strong. Two games left. You win both. You split. You lose both. Play for the draft pick that you fit. And again, who knows what the hell can happen? The
Broncos, that's valid.
The Broncos are not mathematically eliminated, but there's still a weird, funny chance that they can make the playoffs. If the Dolphins can make the playoffs after starting 1-7. Who knows? Before we close, and I wish Brian didn't have technical difficulties because I wanted his input on this too. At the top of when I was getting the show ready, the news broke that John Madden had unfortunately passed away. And I know he was a huge Raider coach, but, he went into the booth. He became America's sweetheart. He is a football guru. He is the namesake of one of the most popular video games, let alone sport video games of all time. Everybody has a Madden memory. I remember him. I remember so many Bronco games in primetime. John Madden was in the booth. The wisecracks, the Frank Caliendo impersonations. Mm-hmm. He is an icon to the game that will definitely be missed.
Yeah.
Dave, do you have any?
That's a valid point. You can't even talk about the NFL without even talking about John Madden. My wife actually, before I did the show today, my wife said, "Babe, you heard?" My wife is not really a big football fan, and first she's like, "Hey, you know John Madden died?" And I looked at my wife like, "Man, you know who John Madden is?" So John Madden, you can't even think about the football without knowing or the NFL without knowing who John Madden is and what he meant to the game, how many players' lives he's touched. how many coaches he's influenced. You can see his blueprint, or imprint rather, on the NFL throughout many different teams and coaches. And so obviously he was beloved by a lot of people in the league, and helped grow the league in the right direction, even though, again, he's a former Raider.
He gets a lifetime pass.
He gets a pass. And I have all of his games right there on the other side of me. So I respect the man. And, my prayers go out to his family. And we're grateful that, you know, his family shared John and all that John brought to the NFL with all of us as fans. So rest in peace.
A mile high salute to John Madden. Thank you for being part of my childhood as a football fan. Dave, thank you for coming on as always. Happy New Year.
You too.
That'll be our show for today. I'd like to wish Broncos country a very happy, healthy new year. I know this last year and a half, this decade has not been the ideal lifestyle, but 2021 to me was great. I got to travel to Greece. I got to see the Broncos play, which is not common living in New York, obviously. And I got to do the show for you guys, and I'm very happy I get to do the show. It's very stressful sometimes putting this together, and I'm hoping we can continue this into 2022 and just reflect on all the positives in 2021. I know COVID's kind of making a comeback. I'm really hoping we're just over with. I'm hoping by this time next year, it's something we could just look back at like, wow, we made it. So I'm doing my cross. I bless you all. Hopefully you all have a happy 2022. And as always, even though we have a few episodes left, we're always looking for Bronco fans. Doesn't matter where in the country, as long as it's Broncos country. I'm Andrew Vanech. Take care.